नमः श्रीयतिराजाय विवेकानंद सूरये सचित सुख स्वरूपाय स्वामिने तापहारिणे। सो वी आर स्टडिंग द साइंस ऑफ मैन according to the sages of the Upanishads. How did they approach this science? How they tried to understand the most difficult to understand, that is human being. Swamiji says, Swami Vivekananda, human being is a curious mixture of devil, man and God. There are three in this one form. That's why it's very difficult. It's not that simple to understand. So how the Upanishadic sages approach the truth? How did they try to understand the relationship between the microcosm and the macrocosm, between the individual and the cosmic, between the created and the creator? Our life is actually this species, this human species alone is the, among all the created beings, has the capacity to inquire into this, to know the relationship between the created and the creator. Know that animal is endowed with that much of brains, cerebral capacity, to put this question and get an answer. So we have studied some stories from the Upanishads. The basic approach is this. So the universe that we perceive through the five senses is the gross universe, the world of name and form. So among all the elements, the five elements, the whole universe is the creation of the five elements, that is the earth, dapaha, water, fire, vayu, and space, akasha. So among these five bhutas or elements, the grossest is the earth. The most gross elements is the earth. Subtler than the earth is water. Subtler than water is the fire. Subtler than the fire is the wind. Subtler than the wind is akasha, space. Up to wind we know. Akasha we have to presume, because everything exists in space. If there is no space, where the creation exists? So there must be something to contain the creation. That's why up to space we understand. What lies beyond the space is not in the perception of the mind, because the mind is limited by the five senses. It can go up to the space through discretion and discrimination. Beyond that we cannot see with the physical eyes, with the five senses. Five senses cannot reach that. But we have to infer a subtler entity which is beyond these five, because these five rest on that. If that subtler is not there, who has created these five? Who actually the fundamental intelligence, who has combined these five elements in different ratios so that the creation could come into existence? So we can infer, but to see and to experience, to know that actually experientially, you need to do sadhana, you need to go beyond the mind, go beyond the world of the five senses. For that, tapas or penance or sadhana is required. Our spirituality is nothing but these methods and sadhanas. Okay, the rishis just did not think, they were not armchair philosophers. Just I sit in a chair and look through the window and then make some guesswork about God. So they pondered. So I see the world with the five senses, I see the world with the mind. So the truth actually is behind the mind. Actually it is a support of the mind, it is a substratum of the mind. So to know that support and substratum of the mind, I need to transcend the mind. How can I do that? Then they pondered on the nature of the mind. Mind is based on ego, mind is based on desire. If there is no desire, if there is no ego or individual, aham we call it, then actually the mind gets dissolved. When the mind gets dissolved, what remains is that homogeneous existence which we call God. There are so many names for this: nirvana or mukti or freedom or kaivalya. God realization, self realization, they're all synonyms. To realize your innate divinity, it's not somewhere, you know, outside in the sky or somewhere in Swargaloka. It is all providing and also within you. If you cannot know, actually, it is which is there in your own heart, you cannot know it outside, because outside where you will search. Though it is all providing, though it is everywhere, how you will know the spirit unless actually you experience it here in the microcosm? So you have to experience it in yourself, then you will experience it everywhere. If you know the mystery of this microcosm, you will know the mystery of the macrocosm. If you know the mystery of the Vesti, you will know the mystery of the Samishti also. If you know the mystery of the individual, you will know the mystery of the cosmic. So the focus has to be given to this. So now today we are so preoccupied with the world of the five senses, so preoccupied with the external world, that we don't pay sufficient attention to this piece of life. How the experience of life is happening. Experience of life is happening from within. Okay, all the time, all the experiences, painful or pleasurable, they're all happening from within, they're happening from the mind. The question should arise in you, what is the mind? So, okay, sometimes the world, the experiences are painful, sometimes they're pleasurable. Is it not possible to have only painful, pleasurable experience to the exclusion of painful experience? When you get that question, you will come to the spiritual path. Now you have taken for granted that the world is a mixture of both. Sometimes I will have pleasure, sometimes I have pain. But you want to avoid painful experiences as much as possible. That is the nature of every creature. But are you successful in that attempt? Nobody wants a painful experience, right? Everybody wants only sukha. Nobody wants dukkha. But you don't want sukha, you don't want dukkha, but it comes. In the same measure it comes. You know, there is a beautiful sloka in Srimad Bhagavatam. Prahlada, he would counsel his fellow students. You know, fellow students were all asuras. He was also an asura, born of Hiranyakashipu. Demonical nature, the people with. So other boys, asura boys, would ask him, see, we don't understand what you are speaking. You are speaking about the absolute, you are speaking about Narayana. We both are actually the same kind of upbringing, you know, same kind of parents. They're all asura group. The Chanda Marka, the teachers were giving them the different kinds of instructions, but Prahlada, you would pay attention, you would give due respect to his teachers, but he considers that as not the highest knowledge. So he was explaining to them, the gist of the Bhagavatam, you can say that actually contains in this sloka. What he says is, Sukam Aindrikam Daitya Deha Yogena Dehinam. Sukam Aindrikam Daitya Deha Yogena Dehinam. That means the sensory pleasure that a person has to get, when an embodied being has to get, every embodied being gets that, he says. Whoever has a physical body, whoever has a structure made up of the five senses, will get inner pleasure in the same measure, whether you're a poor man or a rich man, or actually the wealth of the whole world may be at your disposal, but the sum amount of pleasure that you can derive through the senses is fixed. He says, Sarvatra labhyate daivat yatha dukkham ayatnataha. Daivat means here senses. You know, senses are also called deities, daivas, gods. You know, for every sense there is a presiding deity. Sarvatra labhyate daivat. It is available to every creature. For example, if you just see in humans also, a poor man is there. He will enjoy a meal better than a rich man. Why? Because he has got good appetite. So in English we have a saying, so hunger is the best sauce, because his appetite is good. Even the meals, his coarse meals, he will relish it more than a rich man can enjoy his meals. A rich man has so many things to eat, but his appetite is not that strong. But who enjoys even the sensory pleasure also? You know, eating is a sensory pleasure, basic pleasure, limited pleasures that are available to us. Even those limited pleasures also, only the individuals who are actually at the lower rung of the society, actually, they enjoy more. And if you just look at animals, the animals enjoy better than us. That's why Swami says, no dog eats with the same gusto as a famished dog or wolf. Have you seen a dog actually eating its meal? It has such a strong appetite. Its whole soul is its meals, as it were. It enjoys it, it relishes it so much. You can't enjoy a meal as much as a dog enjoys, because we have other pleasures possible. Okay. So, but when it comes to that gross pleasure, that animals enjoy much better than human beings. So what the Prahlada wants to say is, so these pleasures are limited and they're fixed for every human being. If you try to have more of that pleasure, sensory pleasure, you will not get it. Why? Because the pain, some amount of pain and some amount of pleasure, actually is pleasure and actually pain, they're all fixed. Suppose there is 50 per 50 units of pleasure that is available to you, and you want to make it to 75 units. Okay, if you want to make the pleasure to 75 units, and you will get the pain also to 75 units. There is 50 units of pleasure, 50 units of pain. Now we are all making an effort to make it into 75 units. We want to increase the quantum of pleasure that we can derive from the world. If you increase it by 25 points, from 50 to 75, if you make it, and your pain also will increase from 50 to 75. That is the nature of the world. Therefore, he says, tatra prayaso na kartavyo, yata ayurveha param. Tatra prayaso na kartavyo, yata ayurveha param. Na vindate kshemam, na tatra vindate kshemam, mukunda charanambusham. So, what he meant is, tatra ayurveha param. What happens if you make an attempt? You are expending your lifespan in vain. Okay, you will not have your desire fulfilled. You want to increase the quantum of happiness, but you will never be able to succeed in your endeavor and attempt because some amount of pain, and pleasure, they are fixed. If you increase the pleasure quantity, you will increase the pain quantity also in the same measure. So that is how the world is designed. That's how the world is constructed. It takes a lot of time for us to understand the simple fact of life. You do whatever you want in this life. If you want more pleasure, in the same measure, your pain also will increase. There is no way actually you can have only pleasure to the exclusion of pain in this world. That is the nature of the world, that is the design of the world. And that's why he says actually don't make any attempt. The simple pleasure that you have to get through the physical senses, you will get it anyway. But that quantum is fixed. So now we have to have the question, then the question comes actually, then what should I do then? I have come into this world, we can't just sit idle actually, we have to do something actually. Everybody is making an attempt to enhance their happiness, though they don't become successful in that. You might try again and again, but you will never become successful in enhancing the quantum of happiness here. Because if you want to increase the quantum of happiness, you will be simultaneously increasing the quantum of unhappiness also, to the same measure. So what should you do then? He says, Natatra vindate kshemam mukunda charanambujam. So you have to make an endeavor only to surrender yourself at the feet of the Lord. Where should we invest our energies? To surrender to the feet of the Lord. That His will actually is expressing through the whole of the universe. If you surrender yourself at the feet of the Lord, if you go beyond the mind, if you go beyond this individual consciousness, that is I, you will go beyond the pairs of opposites between pain and pleasure, happiness and unhappiness. Okay, and then actually you will experience the divine. There actually it is bliss absolute. There is no unhappiness. It is actually undiminishing happiness. It is an eternal happiness. It doesn't diminish with the time and its immortality. That lies beyond the mind. So effort you make in this direction, he says, having come here in an embodied state as a physical form with certain senses, okay, you need to do only this. Surrender at the feet of the divine, go beyond the pairs of opposites, go beyond the mind, and you will experience the divine, you will experience your immortal nature. So we know actually in our Puranas also, Upanishads, it's not talked about much, but in Puranas we come across Devas and Asuras. Devas are gods and Asuras are demons. So there are actually, you know, Devas or Asuras, they're not the two different species. And Devas are the people who get the doubt, because they know that the world is a mixture of pain and pleasure. They enjoy things with little discrimination. And Devas also infer the presence of the divine behind the created universe. Because we have not done this universe, Devas are very clear about that. And that's the reason when they want to enjoy the things of the world, they enjoy the things of the world with little caution. Not that they are ascetics and they have the absolute dispassion and they seek only God and the only truth all the time. But Asuras are the people, Asuras are the beings who just plunge headlong into the world. This world is created for our enjoyment. Okay, God has created, okay, but He has created this universe for our enjoyment. So the only objective and goal of life is to enjoy the things of the world as much as you can, to your heart's content. They don't want to think. If you think, actually you will get a doubt whether the world is going to give me the real pleasure, real happiness. You will get a doubt. So if I don't get the real happiness that I am expecting, what should I do? Okay, naturally inquiry comes into your nature. But you don't want. No, if I get a doubt about the world, if I say somebody says the world is a mixture of pain and pleasure, okay, you will not get here only happiness. If you seek happiness, you also have to get unhappiness. You also have to go for misery. No, then actually I will get a doubt. I will not be able to enjoy the things of the world with the intensity with which I want to enjoy. That's why they don't want to discriminate. The people who don't discriminate and who will plunge headlong into the world and wants to seek the pleasures of the world without even getting an iota of doubt are the asuras. Devas, actually, they know that the world is a mixture of pain and pleasure, but yet they cannot resist. Okay? They cannot resist the temptation to enjoy the things of the world. They also enjoy, but with a caution, and also remembering God, because God actually has created this world. The play, whole of the universe, actually His creation. So they, with some trepidation, some caution, and surrendering at the feet of the Lord, they make an attempt, and they express their gratitude to the Divine for giving these little pleasures of life. And they enjoy the things of the world like that. There is a difference between these two. And once they go to Prajapati, Brahma, because they want to know something beyond this world, Prajapati calls for a meeting and asks them, actually, and explains them about Atman. Why he has told about the Atman? This world is a pair of mixture of opposites. You will not get only happiness here. And you have to get to the Atman if you really want to have the highest enjoyment. So this Atman doesn't have these limitations. What are the limitations that we have as an embodied being? This body is subjected to change. This body becomes old. This body dies one day. And that which is beyond all these limitations is the Atman, which is beyond hunger, beyond thirst. It is deathless, it is immortal, it is beyond old age, beyond disease, and beyond all deformities. Deformities happen only to the physical being, because the physical being is constantly changing. So it is unchanging, it is fearless, it is deathless, actually it is beyond hunger and thirst. That's how actually Brahma describes Atman for both gods and demons. As is the custom, both of them, everybody hears, all the asuras have heard, all the gods also have heard what Brahma has said. And afterwards they depart, they go back to their realms. But Indra and Virochana, they wanted to know more about Brahman, more about Atman. Our father, Prajapati, has said that this Atman is beyond all these limitations. This life is very oppressive existence. Let me reach that state which is beyond all the limitations. Let me become immortal. Let me go beyond this hunger and thirst, beyond old age and death. So both of them had developed the desire. So as was the custom in those days, when you approach Guru, you have to carry a few samis, you know, fagots. As a token of your reverence and respect to the Guru, you have to approach him in a formal way. So both of them had taken a few fagots or samis and approached Brahma. But what for you have come, Brahma asked. You have come to know about Atman, more about Atman. You have heard about Atman from you, now we want to know more about Atman, know about consciousness. But Brahma says, okay, then you practice self-control for 35 years and come back to me. Because he wanted to ensure that they are very sincere. You want to ensure that they have the Shraddha, sincerity. They don't give this knowledge of Brahman to everybody and anybody. Are you really serious about it? And Sri Ramakrishna Paramahamsa also did not give this knowledge of the Brahman to everybody and anybody. He just saw whether the boy is really interested to know whether the boy has that Shraddha or not. Only those who have got that seed of Vairagya in them, those who are ready to follow the path of Nivritti, turning inward, those who have that genuine desire to go beyond this pairs of opposites, to go beyond this world of limitations, to go beyond this oppressive existence, which is this embodied existence. So they don't give this knowledge to everybody, anybody, because they don't receive it. They can't receive it. Suppose I am an asura. I want to enjoy the things of the world. That is the whole goal for me. There is no other objective. I don't even get a doubt. I think there is only happiness in this world. If I get many, I will be happy. Or if people give me things of the material things, I will be happy. I think like that. So that is my idea of life. So if somebody says that you will get the thing, along with the thing you will get some pain also. That is how the world is constructed. If I say that, they don't relish that. So for such people, there is no point in giving the knowledge of the Brahman. This life of, you know, renunciation, this Nivritti Marga, this turning inward, they don't relish it much because they think that the world has so much to offer in terms of enjoyment for us. Now I am not able to make myself enjoy because I don't have enough money. Or I don't have things of the material world. That's why I'm suffering. That is my idea of life. So what I will do? So my immediate concern will be to acquire those things. So to acquire those things, what I need to do, I need to get a good job or I need to do some business which give you money. So my concern will be that only. That means I have not come to the conclusion that world is a mixture of opposites. If I seek happiness here, I have to get unhappiness also. I will get unhappiness also in the same measure. That understanding has not come to me. So I am not prepared to turn inward. I am not prepared to seek Atman. I am not prepared to seek God. The desire to know the truth beyond this world of, you know, pairs of opposites has not come to me as yet. So then there's no point teaching, you know, giving the highest instruction to such people. So Brahma wanted to ensure that these people, both Indra and Virochana, had that serious net and they were sincere in their quest for knowledge. So he says, you practice 35 years of self-control and come back to me. So they go back and practice self-control for 35 years and come back to Brahman. Oh Father, as you said that we have practiced 35 years of self-control, now you please tell us about Atman. Then Brahma says, it's very simple and it's very easy. That which you see, when you see your reflection in mirror, that which you see in your eyes is Brahman. It is so close to us. We all ask actually, where is God? When you look into your mirror, okay, if you can look into your own eyes, there is something shining, there is something peeping through these eyes. That is Brahman, Brahma says. So then they ask him, so this reflection we see, when we actually see water also, you can see your reflection. Okay? So is that Brahman? Yes, that is Brahman, Brahma says. They go back and come back and tell me, but when I see in a mirror what I see my own face, right? I see my form, but I don't see Brahman there. I see my own being. I see my physical form. Then Brahma says, then you take bath, put on new clothes, and see your reflection again in mirror and in water, in water body. So they go back and again they come back to Brahma. What I have seen is the same thing. I have seen my own body, but dressed in a new attire, in a new clothes. What else you will see? If you wear new clothes, you will see your own body also. Nothing else you will see. But Brahma actually wanted to take them actually from, you know, lower steps to higher steps. Step by step, step by step, step by step. He wanted to take these two people towards Brahman. But they couldn't get the first point also. See, there is a difference between a doll and a small girl. Okay? What is the difference between a doll and a girl? There you find something. This is a living creature, being, and the doll is inanimate. Today actually we have such dolls, the doll almost looks like, you know, human being. Almost looks like a human being, but there is something missing in the doll. That life principle, that shine in the eyes is missing. It's empty. A living girl, she's not empty, there is something profound in that girl. In a doll, that life is missing. The eyes are also exactly like a living being, but it's empty. Where that consciousness is not there, that Atman is not there. Not just, we may say that prana is not there, that is the difference. Prana is just a breath. You can infuse air and I can actually make it expand and contract. You can actually have a doll which expands and contracts, which expands and contracts. That's not difficult to do, right? No, it's not prana. It is there, something else is there, but we don't notice it. We don't understand that. So both of them go back to Brahma and says that we see our own physical bodies. Then Virochana says, yes, you have seen Atman only. Brahma says, you have seen Atman only. This Atman is indestructible, this is immortal. And Virochana was happy, he doesn't want to ponder further. He goes back, because after all, he's an asura. Okay? He doesn't have that seriousness, he doesn't have the sincerity to know the Atman in toto. But Indra went back and reflected. When Prajapati, father, Brahma told first, that this Atman actually is beyond all the limitations. He said it is deathless, it is birthless, it is beyond thirst and beyond hunger. But when we see in our mirror, we see our own reflection as a physical body, but this physical body is subjected to change, is subjected to hunger, subjected to thirst. So this physical body cannot be the Atman. Atman must be something more, something beyond. I have not got the point right. That's what Indra thinks. And he goes back to Brahma. And then Brahma Prajapati says, oh, you're right. You're right. But he says, then you practice self-control for some more time and come back to me. Again, Indra goes back to his own realm and after 35 years, he comes back to Brahma with the same question. I have not understood what Atman is. Certainly, Atman is not the body. Body is subjected to change. But you said that Atman is deathless, but body is subjected to death. Then Brahma says, the consciousness that you witness in your dream, okay, the consciousness that you witness in your dream is Brahman. So Indra goes back and reflects on this. So in dream we see so many things, you know, sometimes somebody is afflicting us dream also. Okay, in dream also afflictions happen, so many nightmares come to us, right? Most of our dreams are not sweet dreams. If only sweet dreams you get all the time, then you don't have to worry. But sometimes we get nightmares, sometimes good dreams. Let us say a tiger is chasing you in dream, but you will perspire. You are in a forest, suddenly you happen to encounter a tiger. Okay, what happens actually? You perspire, though you got it and you saw the tiger in dream, but all the physical changes happen. So dream cannot be the absolute experience, it cannot be the Atman, because Atman is fearless, he said, but dream also, sometimes we fear. If we see tiger in dream also, we fear. But father told that, Prajapati told that the Atman is fearless. So this consciousness that I see in dream, I cannot be the Brahman, cannot be the absolute, because again actually after some time it's a dream, again you wake up, because it's not a permanent state. So he comes back to Brahma, Prajapati, and tells that dream cannot be the Atman, because dream is a temporary phenomenon and dream we suffer also. We have nightmares, we have bad dreams. So Brahman says, like, practice self-control, five more time and come back to me. This time, again, when Indra comes to Brahma, Brahma says, Sushupti state is Atman. When you go to sleep, in deep sleep, totally absorbed, you have no pain, no pleasure. You are beyond both, because you are not conscious of the physical world, you are not conscious of the physical body, you are not conscious of the mind. You just exist as peace, as bliss. So this deep sleep state itself is Atman, the Brahma says. This is called Sushupti. So Indra goes back and reflects further. How can this be the Atman? Because its state doesn't last long. Only when you wake up from sleep, you say, I have slept well last night. You have got very good sleep. There's not much dream in that sleep. Okay, you got sufficient rest. What you say when you wake up? Ah, I had wonderful sleep. Nice sleep I got, because that sleep refreshed you. But again, it broke, right? For a certain period of time. Again, during the period of sleep, when you are really in sleep, when you are really in sushupti, in deep sleep, you are not aware of that deep sleep consciousness. You are not aware of that state. Only when you woke up, now you are saying that, oh, I have had a very good sleep. I had good sleep. Now you are telling. But during sleep, you are not telling, actually, I'm full of joy. I'm experiencing the peace of the deep sleep. Only when you wake up, you stay. And that sushupti is also for a temporary period of time only, right? For a few hours, we experience it. Not 24 hours, if you are in sushupti, it's okay. But you are not in sushupti all 24 hours. Again, when you wake up, the problems of the world come upon us. Then you have to deal with so many things. You have so many responsibilities. So that is not a continuous experience. It is only a temporary experience for a few minutes. And this cannot be the Atman. Then he goes back to Brahma again. Why have you come again? What is the doubt? I have told you the Sushupti is Atman. Then Indra says, oh father, Sushupti cannot be Brahman, because Atman, because it is temporary. And then Brahma says that, yes, you are right. I appreciate your inquisitiveness. I appreciate your jignasa, he says. This is the kind of sincerity and this is the kind of Shraddha you need to have if you really want to know Atman. And then he appreciates and he tells Indra, that state which is beyond the Sushupti and which is the witness of all these states, wakeful state, dream state, and deep sleep state, which is the witness of all these three states, that is your real existence, that is Suriya, that is immortal, that is a continuous experience, it doesn't diminish its time, that is immortal, that is fearless, that is deathless, he says. Then Indra asks, then how can I bring it into my experience? How am I to be aware of that? Then he said, you need to long for that experience, you need to do sadhana for that, you need to transcend the mind which is based on pairs of opposites. Once you achieve that, you will get that experience. Once you get that experience, you go beyond the world of relativity. That is actually your immortal nature, that is your true nature, that is your real nature. You get that experience through sadhana and be on the path, be on that endeavor. That's what Brahma says. So the instruction is given to both Virochana and Indra. The Indra was serious about knowing about God, knowing about truth, but Virochana was not serious about that. Virochana, because he was asura, he wanted to enjoy the things of the world. That is the only concern he has, that is the only objective of life for him. He doesn't actually have the right understanding that the world is a mixture of pain and pain, pleasure, and I can't have here only the pleasure to the exclusion of pain. There must be something beyond this world. That understanding has to dawn upon you first. Then only you will be a seeker after truth, otherwise not. This is one story, how they have approached Yudhishthira from actually subtle from the gross to the subtle, subtle to the subtler, subtler to the subtlest, from the subtlest to the subtler than the subtlest, the most subtle, that is actually the Brahman or the consciousness. That's how our Upanishadic sages have approached the truth. We have one more story in Brihadaranyaka Upanishad. There are many stories actually. This story is also about Brahman only. You might have heard the great name, Yajnavalkya. Okay, Yajnavalkya, the great sage of the Upanishadic period. So, you know that the kings used to conduct these debates in those days, not on ordinary things, not on secular things, about God and about ultimate truth. In the last class, we discussed that in Panchala, also it used to happen that Panchala king Pravahana used to regularly organize these symposiums where the sages and scholars would discuss on Brahman and God and ultimate reality. Janaka, of course, used to do it on a regular basis. Janaka himself was a Rajarshi. Though sitting on a throne, he was totally detached, a great sage himself, respected by other Brahmarshis, respected by other sages, absolutely untouched by the things of this world, because he had transcended the relativity already, transcended the mind already. So once he organized a symposium, okay, on this Brahman, on the nature of Brahman, because through these symposiums, through debates and discussions, the king wanted to generate awareness about the ultimate reality among his subjects. Those kings were really philosopher kings. India had, you know, philosopher kings for quite considerable period of time. They were not just kings for political power. They want to give the highest thing to the people because they themselves were self-realized souls. They themselves were the people who had known the truth. And such kings ruled this country for a considerable period of time. If you take this Ikshvaku lineage, Rama's lineage, so many kings, enlightened kings, kings actually who had known the truth, the mystery of the universe. And Janaka was one such Rajarshi. So, he organized this symposium, and in that assembly he declared that whoever declares himself as a Brahmajnani, as a knower of Brahman, they can take all these gifts. What were the gifts? 1,000 cows. Cows with gold coins. Cows, gold coins, he offered. Whoever wanted to take, they can take. But they must prove that they are the knower of Brahman. They must answer the questions that other scholars are going to ask. If a person can prove his intellectual mettle and spiritual mettle by participating in this debate, and that individual can take away all these cows, Janaka says. Yajnavalkya goes there with his disciples. As soon as the announcement was made, Yajnavalkya turns around and says to one of his disciples, yeah, take all the cows to our hermitage. All the scholars were sitting, all our people were sitting. Then they were annoyed at the audacity of Yajnavalkya. First you have to prove, we are going to ask you questions. You must answer our question, then you have to prove your intellectual mettle, that you are an enlightened being, then only you will become eligible. Otherwise, simply you want to take away, drive away all the cows to your hermitage. How can be that? It cannot happen. So if anybody has any doubts, anybody can question. Yajnavalkya was a great sage because he had that confidence, because he was a knower of truth. He knows everything. You ask, I shall tell. But nobody has the guts to challenge Yajnavalkya because they have heard about him. Okay? He's a knower of Brahman. Only two knowers of Brahman in that assembly, Yajnavalkya and Janaka. Nobody else has the courage. Because theoretically they know what is Brahman. They also have studied the Vedas, but they have not experienced the truth yet. They have not known the truth experientially. So they could not many could come forward to ask the questions. There was this Rajaguru, the priest of this Janaka, Ashwala. He comes forward and asks the questions. You explain about Parabrahma Tattva. Then Yajnavalkya says that, I don't know, but I bow before it. I don't know about God, but I bow before it. And I want these cows because I'm a poor Brahmin. That's what he says. So that cannot be the answer. So you say that actually simply you want to take care of the cows and you don't know about Brahman, Parabrahma Tattva. So then he says it cannot be expressed in words. It's beyond walk, beyond words and beyond thought. You can't comprehend it and then speak about it. Because it is the source of thought itself, it is the source of speech itself. Speech happens, thought happens because of that. Vijnata ramare kena vijaniyat, Upanishad says. How the knower can be known? He is a knower. Suppose if I know the things, what is that actually that knows me, knows things in me? Is it the mind? No, mind is not self-resplendent. Mind is not self-luminous. Mind is dependent on something else. That's why we need sleep. During the sleep, actually, mind goes back to its source and draws its nourishment and energy and makes the body function next day for 12 hours, 13 hours. Afterwards, again, the night it gets exhausted. What is it saying when it wants to sleep? It's saying that I'm exhausted. I need to charge up myself. That's what the mind is saying. So you sleep. During the sleep, actually, draws its energy from the source of its being. So when I say that actually I know something, it is not the mind which knows these things, because mind is also not self-resplendent. It is dependent upon Atman. It is Atman that knows things, not the mind. So that it is not in our experience as yet. As of now, we are at the level of thought only. So the goal of life should be to cross that thought, to transcend that thought, to transcend the mind. Then you will know the Atman experientially. So except these two, nobody else in the assembly actually has known the Atman experientially. That's why Yajnavalkya says that it cannot be spoken in words. That's why I need these cows. That's why I am going away with the cows. So then Ashwala asks him some other questions. You know, Ashwala was a Purva Mimamsika. You know, Indian, the Shaddarsanas we call six systems of Indian philosophy. The Purva Mimamsakas are basically about karmakandins. You know, Vedas speak about both karmakanda and jnanakanda. All the Upanishads are part of this jnanakanda, knowledge portion. And Vedas also has the karma portion. They used to do a lot of sacrifices and yajnas with the intention of going to heaven. And how an yajna has to be performed, and what kind of, you know, yajna vatika, the place of yajna, how it should be, how the homakunda should be, the fireplace, how many bricks it should contain, what mantras you should recite at the time of yajna for different kinds of yajna, all that is actually part of karma kanda. So this Ashwala was a karma kandin. Okay, his intention was to go to heaven. He used to think that Vedas talk about only going to heaven. So this karmakanda is so important. Jnanakanda is not as important as karmakanda. Jnanakanda speaks about something abstract philosophy which an ordinary man cannot understand. That is not actually the real essence of Vedas. So the real essence of Vedas is karmakanda. Though the people who discuss and debate, and they would actually stick to only karmakanda and saying that it is the highest part of the Vedas. And this Ashwala was also one kind of such kind of person. So he is interested only in going to heaven. So he asks about how to go to heaven and what are the mantras to be chanted in different yajnas. And who are the presiding deities of different mantras? You know, mantras have the presiding deities also. So Yajnavalkya, because he's after all the knower of Brahman, for him to answer this question was a simple job. It was a cakewalk, you know. All these things were on his fingertips. So immediately he answers all the questions of Ashwala. Then Ashwala keeps quiet. Now I cannot challenge this Yajnavalkya. He's really a knower of Brahman. He just keeps quiet. Then somebody else gets up and asks some other questions on Purva Mimamsa and also on some yajnas. And Yajnavalkya answers those questions to the satisfaction of the questioner. And now the lady by name Gargi, she stands up and she wants to challenge Yajnavalkya. And she asks the question, "Oh Yajnavalkya, please tell me actually, all the beings and all the inanimate and sentient and insentient beings, where they rest, what is the resting place, what is the substratum, what is the basis, what is the hypostasis for this universe?" And Yajnavalkya says, "Space. It is Akasha, because without space nothing can rest, right? For the universe to stand, you need something done. And where the universe stands, it is in space. So space is the substratum." Then Gargi asks, "What is the substratum for space? What is the basis of space?" And then Yajnavalkya says, "Parabrahma, the supreme truth. The supreme consciousness is the substratum for space." And then she asks again, actually, "Well, what is the substratum of Parabrahman, the supreme reality?" Then Yajnavalkya becomes angry, gets annoyed. "Oh Gargi, a woman of your intellect should not ask such a foolish question, lest your head should fall off," he says. "You must not put such a foolish question, because when I say Parabrahman, it or he or she is the absolute. It is self-resplendent. Everything rests on it. It doesn't need anything to support itself. If something, it needs something else to support it, then you may have ask actually what it is supported by, the next thing also. It goes ad infinitum, right? If you ask the world is supported by God, God is supported by whom? God 2. God 2 is supported by whom? God 3. God 3 is supported by whom? God 4. So it goes on ad infinitum. So when we use the word Parabrahman or the Supreme or Consciousness here, when you say that absolute, absolute we mean that which doesn't need any support. It rests on itself. It is the absolute. The very word means that. Implies that. It doesn't need any substratum. It rests on its own strength. It is self-luminous, self-resplendent. We say Swayam Prakashaka and Swayam Bhu, that exists by itself. That exists by itself, that's why it's absolute, that's why it's God, that's why it's supreme. Otherwise, why it is supreme? If it is dependent on something else, why you will call it supreme? You should not call it supreme. It is secondary. And this is how actually Yajnavalkya says, you should not answer a question like this. This Parabrahman doesn't need anything to to support him, and he rests on himself, and he stands on his own strength. That's why it is absolute. And then Gargi keeps quiet. Then one more person by name Uddhalaka asks, what is Sutratman, what is Antaryamin? What is Sutratman and what is Antaryamin? So this is actually, these were questions were asked in the Upanishads. In Bhagavad Gita also, you come across this point. The Lord says, Mattah parataram nanyat kinchit asti dhananchaya. Mai sarvamidam protam sutre maniganaiva. Okay, just as the beads are strung on a string, the whole universe is strung in me, he says. Just as beads are strung on a string, you know, like a rosary. You are like the beads are there and also string is there. The string connects all the beads. In the same way, all the beings are interconnected through me, the Lord says. Mattah parataram nanya, there is nothing beyond me, Udhananjaya. Mai sarvamidam protam sutre maniganaiva. So this is my real nature. This question was asked way back in the Upanishad. So Bhagavad Gita is the essence of the Upanishads. All the thoughts that are contained in the Upanishads are actually there. Krishna actually brings all the thoughts from Yajnakanda to Jnanakanda. Whole thing actually, one go, he covers. So that's why Bhagavad Gita is the gist of all the Upanishads. So Uddhalaka asks him about the Sutratman and Antaryamin. What is Antaryamin? Antaryamin actually which supports the microcosm. That aspect of the consciousness which supports this individual, which supports the jiva, actually is the Antaryamin. This Antaryami actually helps you perform all the functions. It is a substratum of the mind, substratum of all the senses. For the external universe, that is actually the consciousness is there. So this Pindanda is connected with the Brahmanda, the microcosm is connected with the macrocosm. So this question of Sutratma is also answered by Yajnavalkya. Gargi stands up again, and she says now actually, with the permission of the assembly, of the sages and scholars that are present here, I want to ask few more questions to Yajnavalkya. Okay, Yajnavalkya says, you ask what you want to ask. And again she asks the same question, more or less. What he says is the same thing. What is the subtlest thing in this universe actually, on which actually the whole physical universe, manifested universe rests? She says again, Akasa. And Akasa rests on what? Then unconditioned Parabrahman, this is. And now she asks, explain Parabrahman to us, explain this unconditioned Brahman to us. And she wants to put Yajnavalkya in a trouble. Because you cannot explain in words. Now you want me to explain about something which cannot be spoken of, which cannot be expressed in words. The unconditioned Brahman you explain to us, she says. How it is possible? It's a paradox. It's a conundrum. It's a difficult knot at one tie. Then Yajnavalkya invokes the authority of the Vedas. The Vedas say, Vedas declare that is inexpressible. He himself could have said that is inexpressible. He told this to Ashwala. But when Gargi asks, he says, he invokes the authority of the Vedas. That's why Veda Pramana, we say. Whatever that Vedic sages have spoken, that is absolute. You cannot question. Because there's a Arsha Prayoga. That is inexpressible. I am not saying this. The sages of the Vedas had declared that. He himself was a sage. He could have said that, but he didn't say. But he quoted the authority from which he wants to derive strength. Because it cannot be expressed in words. Then how to reach that? Then simply this. Na iti, na iti. You just reflect on the nature of your being. This physical body is sustained by mind. Mind is nothing but actually the pairs of opposites, nothing but five elements. Body is made up of five elements, mind is made up of three gunas. All this philosophy is not spoken of there, but they're just by using neti neti. If you have deep longing to know the truth, by coming to this Nivritti Marga, you will experience the truth. You will experience Brahman. It is so close to every one of us. That is a profound discovery that our rishis have made. And then Gargi declares, among all the people that are present in this assembly, I declare this Yajnavalkya as an knower of Brahman. If there is anybody in this assembly who is a true representative of the truth spoken of in the Vedas as Vedaham etam purusham mahantam adityavarnam tamasastu paraha. Adityavarnam tamasas paraha. Tamasastu paraha. Adityavarnam means of the radiance of the sun. Okay? The physical universe, which is the brightest object that we get to see, it is the sun. There is no object which is brighter than the sun. So when they have described Brahman, they said that is even brighter than the sun. The Supreme is so radiant, so resplendent. But why don't I see? Because the mind is not allowing you to see that. You transcend the mind, you experience that. Sri Ramakrishna Paramahamsa, when he had experienced the Divine Mother Kali, he saw that light, a torrential light, a light actually just came like a wave and actually engulfed him, and he fell unconscious. That luminosity was so bright, you can't bear to see it with physical eyes. When Krishna had shown his Vishwarupa also, not many could see, not many could gauge it, including Arjuna. Oh Lord, actually. So Vithutra, this form, I'm not able to gauge it because it is so grand, so majestic, and so luminous. So these were the few people who could see that with their physical eyes, Krishna, when he had shown his Vishwarupa. So that Robert Oppenheimer, actually, when they exploded the atom bomb, he quoted a sloka from the Bhagavad Gita, and when Krishna says his Divi Sahasra, like, you know, thousands of the suns, the light, actually, that thousands of suns, if you bring to one place, how much of light would come? That much of light came when he first exploded the atom bomb. And he saw, it was so bright, so dazzling. So that is there behind this world of name and form, the truth, which is a million times brighter than the sun. Mahatma Gandhi also says this in his autobiography. He says, I have had a faint glimmer of that truth which is a million times brighter than the sun. That means actually you can infer that he has had a glimpse of the truth. That's what he declares. So this is there behind the world of name and form. To experience that, you have to come to the path of yoga. Path of yoga, I don't just mean the physical yoga or hatha yoga, or doing asanas and actually keeping the body in a fit condition, living for 80 years, or 90 years, 100 years. Okay, that is also yoga, but it is hatha yoga. So they actually developed this hatha yoga so that actually you can practice yoga better. Okay, if you really want to sit in meditation for 2 hours, you can't just sit if you are, decrepit, your body is not strong. You need a fit instrument to do sadhana, spiritual sadhana, otherwise there will be reaction. A sick man cannot practice yoga. A sick man cannot sit in yoga for 2 hours. You have to sit in a posture, right? How you can meditate if you are sick physically and mentally? So you need a fit instrument, mentally fit and physically fit. Only such people can practice yoga. But today our understanding is all the spirituality and yoga is after 60 years you have to come to this yoga path. Okay? When you become a spent force, physically and mentally, all your energies are over now. You are given the best part of your life to the world and worldly things. This is the worldliness, we have come to such a state, the soul-sickening worldliness, I prefer to call it. Soul-sickening worldliness. And Sri Ramakrishna Paramahamsa used to express his surprise looking at the worldliness that was there in Calcutta population at that point of time. How these people, how materialistic they are. He used to say, worldliness, worldliness, worldliness. They don't understand anything other than the physical world, anything other than the world of five senses. This is the, plight of the descendants of sages and rishis. That's all because, the education system, the kind of education system that we have devised and this imitation of the West, that we are a developing country, that we need to develop in the model of the West, all these ideas have taken us away from our spiritual moorings. So this yoga is not practiced that seriously in this country. Yoga means not just asanas. Yoga means to yoke oneself with the divine, to connect yourself with the divine. That is the ultimate objective. Our people have understood that however hard you might try for happiness in this world of relative existence, you will get this only in a small measure. If you want to increase the happiness, you have to increase the unhappiness also to the same measure. So there's no point in wasting your energies here, trying not to make ourselves happy constantly. More happiness, you will not get it. Last class or before that last Sunday, actually, we discussed this, that Sri Ramakrishna's example of bird and the master. Okay. Yata shakuni sutrena prabaddho. Disham disham patitva anyatra ayatnam alabdva bandhanam eva upasreyata. The shakuni is a bird that is tied, okay, with a string. The bird can go in different directions as much as the string allows it. It can't go beyond that. Okay, it can't fly into the infinite space just like that because it is tied with a string. In the same way, we are also held by these strings. What are these strings? These desires of the material world. People think that if I get name and fame, if I become popular, I will be very happy. You will try for popularity, and after getting popularity, you understand what a trouble actually you have pushed yourself into. And we also think that actually if I have plenty of money, I will be happy. I will be infinitely happy, infinitely joyful. And you go and ask the people who have money, who are super rich, the problems. You will understand better. You are much better than them in terms of happiness. Okay? And we are also trying for happiness through other means, like material things. If I get all the material things of the world, the best of the material things of the world. Many people have it now. Okay, whatever you are desiring now, actually, many people have it in the world. Go and see how happy they are. Okay, are they on cloud nine? You ask, are you on cloud nine? Because all the things I covet, you already have. So you must be 1,000 times, more happier than me. Is it the case? You ask. Yeah, nobody will give you, a satisfactory answer. Everybody has something else they want to achieve. The sense of dissatisfaction, the sense of unfulfillment is so high today. Perhaps actually never before it was like this. This much of material wealth, these many things were not there for previous generations. But in terms of happiness, they were much better than us. We have made a mess of life, for sure. Okay, in spite of having all these things, we should have been the happiest generation, but we are not. Because we are not figuring out what this is. The attention is not on this. We are not actually yoga practitioner. Today our idea of yoga is when you don't want to fall sick, and that's why you want to come to Hatha Yoga. There you have got stopped. Now you have to go to the next step, the real yoga, which Swami Vivekananda speaks about, and which the Lord Krishna speaks about in the Bhagavad Gita. Bhakti Yoga, Karma Yoga, Jnana Yoga, and Raja Yoga. All these yogas we have discussed in brief many times here. Bhakti, Sri Ramakrishna says that is the easiest yoga that can be practiced in this age. Just surrender to the feet of the Lord. Just as we have discussed, as Prahlada says, Tatra prayaso na kartavyam, yata ayurveyah param, na tatra vindate kshemam mukunda charanambujam. To get to the feet of the Lord is the sole objective of life, that's all. Day and night think about the feet of the Lord. If you are upasaka of saguna sakara, if you want to worship the Lord in a form, then that is the easiest. Or if you want to worship the impersonal aspect of Brahman, impersonal aspect of the Lord, who is all-pervading spirit, you can surrender to that also. Now, I don't believe in a God with a form. Fine, okay, you surrender to the impersonal. But you must take the path. Not I but thou, not I but thou. I am just an instrument in the hands of the divine. The whole creation is his. All the beings are his. He is making all the beings dance to his tune. He is the operator. You are only the machine. The machine is being operated by him. Suddenly, somehow, this fictitious I has come, entered into it. This thief has entered. This thief actually is troubling. You get away with the thief, actually. You drive this thief off from your body and from your being, and you are in infinite bliss. This is a thief. This is a fictitious projection of consciousness, this ego. It is baseless, it is rootless, it is frivolous. But we hold on to it with all our might, because we have the fear. If the ego is dropped, it's as good as death, we think. No. It's a fictitious thing. But that requires tremendous strength to drop this ego. It's so rooted in the body and the mind. We think this is this. And that's the reason we are not able to drop the I. As Sri Ramakrishna says, all the time you practice this sadhana, yoga, not I but thou, not I. I am an instrument. I am yantra and your entry. You are operating this machine, O Lord, not I. There's nothing like I. This I is fictitious, superstitious. We are all like, you know, in the forest, if you see this African forest, many times the foxes, they go. After lion eats away its kill, the best parts of the kill it eats and then actually leaves. Some leavings are left there. And the foxes and then wolves, they go and eat. Okay? A lion doesn't care. Okay, he gives it. Joyfully it gives it best part. So he allows the jackals and foxes to appropriate a part of its kill, to satisfy their hunger. We are also like that. We have become. The whole universe belongs to God. He is the owner. And you are appropriating something from this means what? You are appropriating the lion's property. Then you have become a jackal. Okay? It may be a little offensive. We're sorry. But that's what we are doing. So you give the universe. The universe belongs to God. Okay? It's his property, including this body, when I say that universe. This body and mind also belongs to God. What belongs to God? You give back to him. You're free, right? You're free. That's what we need to do it. We are not the owner of anything, including this body and mind also. Because when the universe belongs to him, that which is a part of the universe also should belong to him, right? From where this I has come is a mystery. You need to solve that mystery. If you solve that mystery, you become one with the Brahman. So our rishis have explored this and found out this ego is actually a fictitious thing, a totally unreal entity. This is called Maya. Get rid of this Maya. Be on that job, be on that path, and you will attain illumination, you will attain total fulfillment. After attaining fulfillment, when you look back, you understand that it's all drama, it's all mere fun. How come that I got deluded for these many births, you think? For such a long period of time, how can actually I got deluded? You would be surprised at your own ignorance. So, okay, we shall stop here for today because the bell has gone. We shall meditate for 2 minutes before we disperse. So with this, another few more stories are there, I will take up afterwards. The Science of Man, the stories from the Upanishads. This is the fifth episode, fifth talk discussion. It's over. From next week onwards, we shall take some other topic.
Oh. Yeah. हृदये न च भा Madina Bandho Tejas Taranti Tarasa Tvayi Tripta Trishna Rage Kriti Rutapathe Tvayi Rama Krishne Matyamritam Tava Padam Maranorme Nasham Tasma Tvameva Sharanam Mama Dina Bandha Krityam Karoti Kalusham Kuhakanta Kari Shnantam Shivam Suvimalam Tavanam Natha Yasmadaham Tvasharano Jagade Gamya Tasma Tvameva Sharanam Mama Dina Bandha Om Sthapakaya Cha Dharmasya Sarvadharma Swaropine Avatar Varishthaya Ramakrishnaya Te Namaha Om Namah Shri Bhagavate Ramakrishnaya Namo Namaha Om Namah Shri Bhagavate Ramakrishnaya Namo Namaha Om Namah Shri Bhagavate Ramakrishnaya Namo Namaha
Narayani Namostu.
शारदे ज्ञानदायिके पापेभ्यो नः सदा रक्ष कृपामयि नमोऽस्तु ते रामकृष्णगतप्राणा तन्नाम श्रवणप्रिया तद्भा चरितं यस्याः पवित्रं जीवनं तथा पवित्रता स्वरूपिण्यै तस्यै कुर्मो नमो नमः देवीं प्रसन्नां प्र प्रणतार्तिहन्ति योगेन्द्रपूज्यां युगधर्मपात्रीं तां शारदां भक्तिविज्ञानदात्रीं दयास्वरूपां प्रणमामि नित्यं स्नेहेन बध्नासि मनोस्मदीयं दोषान् शेषान् चित्ते भीषिञ्च चित्तं कुरुनासु शान्तं जननीं शारदां देवीं रामकृष्णं जगद्गुरुं पादपद्मे तयोः श्रित्वा प्रणमा
పేజ్ 113 1 1 3
ప్రభు హరి నామము భజనము సేయుము పరమ సుఖంబును బడయుట కొరకు ప్రభు హరి నామము భజనము సేయుము పరమ సుఖంబును బడయుట కొరకు ప్రభు హరి నామము భజనము సేయుము ఇహ జీవనమును సుఖముగా గడిపి
ఇహ జీవనమును
పరమున బడయుము పరమ పదంబును ఇహ
జీవనమును సుఖముగా
గడిపి పరమున బడయుము పరమ పదంబును మోక్ష ఫలంబును సదా భుజింతువు
మోక్ష ఫలంబును సదా
ప్రభు హరి నామా ప్రాభవమటిది
మోక్ష ఫలంబును సదా భుజింతువు ప్రభు హరి నామా
नाम प्रभव मटिदे प्रभु हरि नाम भजनमु सेयु मो परम सुखम गुनु बड़युट कोरकु प्रभु हरि नाम भजनमु सेयु దేవదేవుడు మహామహేశుడు
దేవదేవుడు మహామహేశుడు
అంచితముగతన పంచముఖంబుల
దేవదేవుడు మహామహేశుడు
అంచితముగతన పంచముఖం సదా జపించెడు సన్మంత్రంబును
సదా జపించెడు సన్మంత్రంబును
సదా భజించెడు సన్నామంబును
సదా భజించెడు సన్నామంబును
పుడో సగద శ్రీహరి నామము సదా
జపించెడు సన్మంత్రంబును
సదా భజించెడు
సన్నామంబును నీకి
పుడో సగద శ్రీహరి నామము ప్రభు హరి నామము భజనము సేయుము పరమ సుఖంబును బడయుట కొరకు ప్రభు హరి నామము భజనము సేయుము పరమ సుఖంబును బడయుట కొరకు ప్రభు హరి నామము భజనము సేయుము నారాయణ హరి నారాయణ హరి నారాయణ హరి నారాయణ
నారాయణ హరి నారాయణ హరి నారాయణ హరి నారాయణ
నారాయణ హరి నారాయణ హరి నారాయణ హరి నారాయణ హరి నారాయణ హరి నారాయణ హరి నారాయణ
నారాయణ హరి నారాయణ హరి నారాయణ హరి నారాయణ
నారాయణ హరి నారాయణ హరి నారాయణ హరి నారాయణ నారాయణ హరి నారాయణ
నారాయణ హరి నారాయణ హరి 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 నారాయణ హరి నారాయణ
నారాయణ
narayana hari narayana
narayana hari narayana hari narayana
narayana hari narayana hari narayana hari narayana
narayana hari
narayana hari narayana hari narayana narayana hari narayana
narayana hari
narayana hari narayana hari narayana narayana hari narayana hari narayana hari narayana
narayana hari narayana hari
narayana hari narayana narayana hari narayana hari narayana hari narayana
narayana hari narayana hari
narayana hari narayana
పేజ్ 152 152
तुम बिन मोरी कौनो खबर ले 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 गोवर्धन गिरिधारी गोवर्धन गिरिधारी गोवर्धन गिरिधारी मोर मुकुट पीतांबर सोहे मोर मुकुट पीतांबर सोहे मोर मुकुट पीतांबर सोहे मोर मुकुट पीतांबर सोहे कुंडल की छवि न्यारी कुंडल की छवि न्यारी गोवर्धन गिरिधारी
गोवर्धन
गिरिधारी भरी सभा में द्रौपदी ठाड़ी भरी
सभा में द्रौपदी
ठाड़ी भरी सभा में द्रौपदी ठाड़ी
भरी सभा में द्रौपदी ठाड़ी
लाज राखी गिरिधारी लाज राखो गिरिधारी गोवर्धन गिरि गिरिधर नागर मेरा
के प्रभु गिरिधर नागर
मेरा के प्रभु गिरिधर नागर
मेरा के प्रभु गिरिधर नागर
चरण कमल बलिहारी चरण कमल बलिहारी गोवर्धन गिरिधारी
गोवर्धन गिरिधारी
तुम बिन मोरी कौन खबर ले तुम बिन मोरी कौन खबर ले
तुम बिन मोरी कौन खबर ले
गोवर्धन गिरिधारी
गोवर्धन गिरिधारी
गोवर्धन
పేజ్ 164 164
గోవింద మాధవ గోపాల కేశవ నరసింహాచ్యుత నారాయణ
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 దశరథ నందన సీతా మనోహర దానవ మర్దన దయానిధే
దశరథ నందన సీతా మనోహర దానవ మర్దన దయానిధే
దశరథ నందన సీతా మనోహర దానవ మర్దన దయానిధే
దశరథ నందన సీతా మనోహర దానవ మర్దన
राम राघव राजीव लोचन मात फलदा करी वरदा
राम राघव राजीव लोचन मात फलदा करी वरदा
राम राघव राजीव लोचन कामित फलदा करी वरदा
राम राघव राजीव लोचन कामित फलदा करी वरदा
कृष्ण केशवा अम्बुज लोचन कामित फलदा करी वरदा
कृष्ण केशवा अम्बुज
अम्बुजलोचन कामित फलदा करि वरदा राम राम गोविंद राम कल्याण राम पाहि 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 श्री राम राम पटाभिराम कोदंड 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 राम पाहि राम राम नयनाभिराम लोकाभिराम 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 पाहि जलधिशयन रविचंद्र विलोचन जलज भवस्तुत श्रीराम 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 कौसल्यात्मज कामित फलदा मारुति सेवित पाहि 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 राम राम पाहि हरे राम राम पाहि जय जय राम राम पाहि हरे राम राम पाहि जय जय राम राम पाहि हरे राम राम पाहि जय जय राम राम पाहि हरे राम राम पाहि जय जय राम राम पाहि 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 राम राम पाहि
31 చివరి రెండు చరణ.
కర్పూర గౌరం కరుణావతారం, కర్పూర గౌరం కరుణావతారం, కర్పూర గౌరం కరుణావతారం, కర్పూర గౌరం కరుణావతారం. సంసార సారం భుజగేంద్రహారం, సంసార సారం భుజగేంద్రహారం, సంసార సారం భుజగేంద్రహారం, సంసార సారం భుజగేంద్రహారం. కర్పూర గౌరం కరుణావతారం, కర్పూర గౌరం కరుణావతారం. సంసార సారం భుజగేంద్రహారం, సంసార సారం భుజగేంద్రహారం. సదా వసంతం హృదయారవిందే, సదా వసంతం హృదయారవిందే, సదా వసంతం హృదయారవిందే. భవం భవాని సహితం నమామి, భవం భవాని సహితం నమామి, భవం భవాని నమామి, భావం భవాని నమామి, భావం భవాని సహితం నమామి, భావం భవాని సహితం నమామి, భావం భవాని సహితం నమామి, భావం భవాని సదా వసంతం హృదయారవిందే, భవం భవాని సహితం నమామి, భవం భవాని సహితం నమామి, భవం భవాని సహితం నమామి, సహితం నమామి. కర్పూర గౌరం కరుణావతారం, కర్పూర గౌరం కరుణావతారం, కర్పూర గౌరం కరుణావతారం, కర్పూర గౌరం కరుణావతారం. సంసార సారం భుజగే ప్రహారం, సంసార సారం భుజగేంద్రహారం, సంసార సారం భుజగేంద్రహారం, సంసార సారం భుజగేంద్రహారం. సదా వసంతం హృదయారవిందే, సదా వసంతం హృదయారవిందే, సదా వసంతం హృదయారవిందే, సదా వసంతం హృదయారవిందే. భవం భవాని సహితం నమామి, 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 భవం భవాని.
సహితం నమామి భవం భవాని సహితం నమామి
భవం భవాని సహితం నమామి
భవం భవాని సహితం నమామి
భవం భవాని సహితం నమామి
భవం భవాని
సహితం నమామి శివ 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 నామ సుమర నర
శివ 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 నామ సుమర నర
శివ 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 నామ సుమర నర
శివ 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 శివ
సకల మనోరథ పూరణకారీ
సకల మనోరథ పూరణకారీ
శివ 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 నామ సుమర నర
శివ 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 నామ సుమర నర
రావణ నామలియో దృఢ మనసే
రావణ నామలియో దృఢ మనసే
రావణ నామలియో దృఢ మనసే
రావణ నామలియో దృఢ మనసే
సకల దేవాజ్ఞా శిరధారీ
రావణ నామలియో దృఢ మనసే సకల దేవాజ్ఞా శిరధారీ
శివ 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 నామ సుమర నర
శివ 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 నామ సుమర నర
నందే గణ జబ సుమరణ కీనో
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 కాల పాశ తత్కాల నివారే నందే గణ జబ
సుమరణ కీన్హో
కాల పాశ తత్కాల నివారే శివ 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 నామ సుమర నర
శివ 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 శివ
నామ సుమర నర ఉపమన్యో ముని కరే తపస్యా
ఉపమన్యో ముని కరే తపస్యా
ఉపమన్యో ముని కరే తపస్యా
ఉపమన్యో ముని కరే తపస్యా
దూధ సముద్ర కియో బడ భారీ
ఉపమన్యో ముని కరే తపస్యా
దూధ సముద్ర కియో బడ భారీ శివ 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 నామ సుమర నర
శివ 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 శివ
राम सुमरन र
ब्रह्मानन्दयहि परमाङ्गे
ब्रह्मानन्दयहि परमाङ्गे
ब्रह्मानन्दयहि परमाङ्गे
ब्रह्मानन्दयहि परमाङ्गे
भक्तिदान दीजे त्रिपुरारे ब्रह्मानन्दयहि
वरमाङ्गे
भक्तिदान दीदे त्रिपुरारे शिव 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 नाम सुमरनर शिव 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 नाम सुमरनर सकल मनोरथ पूरणकारे सकल मनोरथ पूरणकारे शिव 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 नाम सुमरनर शिव 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 नाम सुमरनर शिव 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 नाम सुमरनर
యాభై 58
కళి కళి బోలో రోషనా কালি কালি বলো রোশনা 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 তোর পদ ধ্যান तोर पद ध्यान
नमः अमृत पान
करो पद ध्यान नमः अमृत पान करो पद ध्यान
नमः अमृत पान
यदि पेते प्राण थाके बासना काली काली बोलो रोशना काली काली बोलो रोशना काली काली बोलो रोशना काली काली बोलो रोशना বন্ধু সুতদারা পরিজন
ভাই বন্ধু সুতদারা পরিজন
সঙ্গে রদশোর নাহে কোন জন
ভাই বন্ধু সুতদারা পরিজন
সঙ্গে রদশোর নাহে কোন জন দুরন্ত সমান বাঁধি দুরন্ত সমান
বাঁধিবে যখন
দুরন্ত সমান বাঁধিবে যখন দুরন্ত शमन
बाधि बेजखन
विनय चरण के हो तारुणा काली काली बोलो रशना काली काली बोलो रशना काली काली बोलो रशना काली काली बोलो रशना दुर्गा नाम के बोलो एक बार
दुर्गा नाम के बोलो एक बार
दुर्गा नाम के बोलो एक बार दुर्गा नाम के
बोलो एक बार
संगेरा संबोल दुर्गा नाम मात दुर्गा नाम के
बोलो
शम्भो दुर्गा नाम मा अनित्य संसार नहीं परवार अनित्य संसार
नहीं परवार
अनित्य संसार नहीं परवार अनित्य संसार
नहीं परवार
सकलिया सर वे भेद को ना काली काली बोलो रशना काली काली बोलो रशना काली काली बोलो काल विफले गेलो
गेलो गेलो काल
विफले गेलो 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 काल विफले गेलो
गेलो गेलो
काल
विफले गेलो
देखो ना काल निकटे येलो
गेलो
गेलो काल विफले गेलो देखो ना काला निकटे येलो प्रसाद बोले काली 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 बोलो
प्रसाद बोले काली
काली काली बोलो प्रसाद बोले काली 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 बोलो प्रसाद बोले काली
काली काली बोलो
दूर हो बेशब यम यंत्रणा काली काली बोलो रशना काली काली बोलो रशना काली काली बोलो रशना काली काली बोलो रशना गौर पद ध्यान नमामृत पान करो पद ध्यान
नमामृत पान
यदि पेते प्राण थाके बासना काली काली बोलो रशना काली काली बोलो रशना काली काली बोलो रशना काली काली बोलो रशना ओम श्री चंडे चामुंडेश्वरी ओम श्री चंडे ओम श्री चंडे चामुंडेश्वरी
ओम श्री चंडे चामुंडेश्वरी
दुर्जन घातिनि दयामये,
दुर्जन घातिनि दयामये,
दुर्जन घातिनि दयामये,
दुर्जन घातिनि दयामये,
जग जननी जय सज्जन पालिनि,
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 शक्तिदाते शिवे कृपामये,
शक्तिदाते शिवे कृपामये,
शक्तिदाते शिवे कृपामये,
शक्तिदाते शिवे कृपामये,
जग जननी जय सज्जन पालिनि,
जग जननी जय सज्जन पालिनि,
शक्तिदाते शिवे कृपामये,
शक्तिदाते शिवे कृपामये।
ॐ श्री चण्डे चामुण्डेश्वरी, ॐ श्री
चण्डे चामुण्डेश्वरी,
ॐ श्री चण्डे चामुण्डेश्वरी,
ॐ श्री चण्डे चामुण्डेश्वरी,
दुर्जन घातिनि दयामयी,
दुर्जन घातिनि दयामयी,
दुर्जन घातिनि दयामयी,
दुर्जन घातिनि दयामयी,
जग जननि जय सज्जन पालि,
जग जननि जय सज्जन पालिनि,
जग जननि जय सज्जन पालिनि,
जग जननि जय सज्जन पालिनि,
शक्तिदाते शिवे कृपामये,
शक्तिदाते शिवे कृपामये,
शक्तिदाते शिवे कृपामये,
शक्तिदाते शिवे कृपामये,
जग जननि जय सज्जन पालिनि,
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 शक्तिदाते शिवे कृपामये,
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 शक्तिदाते शिवे कृपामये। जय भगवान श्री राम कृष्ण देव की
जय,
जय श्री शारदा माई की
जय,
जय स्वामी विवेकानंद महाराज की जय, जय।